Unit 8. Sindbad the Sailor. Let us study about the hardships faced by Sindbad the Sailor during his journey. You must be surprised to know how, after having met with shipwreck 5 times and encountering uninvited dangers, I was still in a condition to face the hardships of life. I, myself, find it difficult to believe when I look back, but I give complete credit to my good fortune that did not leave me in the darkest of my phases in life. However, after 1 complete year of tranquility, I prepared myself for a 6th voyage. Regardless of the fact that my family and friends kept insisting that I should stay back home and not travel again. Instead of following the Persian Gulf route, I preferred traveling overland to a large extent, and finally my journey started from a distant Indian port with a captain who wished to make a long voyage. Thereafter, we got stuck in bad weather and we were completely unaware of our whereabouts. Neither the captain nor the pilots were able to help us with the directions. The captain of the ship at one point of time declared that we were in the most dangerous spot upon the whole wide sea and had been caught by a current which ultimately led to our destruction. Oh, my ears just couldn't believe this, in view of the fact that all the sailors were there to help us. We ultimately found ourselves at the foot of a mountain that rose sheer out of the sea, and we managed to make our way to the shore. The only things that we could carry along with us were some valuable belongings. We heard the captain making some important announcements, which we found difficult to accept. Now that we were there, we realized that it seemed almost impossible to return from such a disastrous spot, and it was only a matter of time that we would cease to exist. We were so disheartened to think that we had nowhere to go but to sit and stare. Our world was ripping apart and we could hardly do anything. The rock-solid mountain served as the boundary of the large island. The narrow strip of rocky shore upon which we stood served as the graveyard for a 1,000-gallon ship's wrecked over there. All around us were humongous quantities of the most upmarket merchandise and goods strewn across the rocks, some buried under the rocks, but at that time, it only made the situation gloomier. I happened to notice a very strange thing. A river of clear, fresh water, which gushed out from the mountain, instead of flowing into the sea, as rivers generally do, turned off sharply and flowed out of sight under a natural archway of rock. I was very curious to see this, so I went closer to find out what was inside the cave. The walls of the cave were thick with diamonds and rubies, and masses of crystal and ambergris were scattered all over the floor. We could hardly do anything except think about what our fate had in store for us, for there was no possibility of climbing the mountain, and if a ship did appear, it could only have shared our ill fate. The first thing our captain did was to divide equally all the food we possessed. How much time a man could survive depended on the time he could make his portion last. I myself could live upon very little. However, the time of my end was fast approaching. I had a very small portion of the stock of provisions left with me. I realized that I should start to think about making preparations for my own grave, and this made me regret leaving behind the comforts and luxuries of life. But immediately an idea came to me. I could see the river at a faraway point. I thought to myself, if I could build a raft and make my way through the swiftly flowing water, if I were able to survive all those hardships, and if my lucky charm was with me, I might be able to find myself in a new world, for the only way to survive was to make a last effort. Hence, I decided to make a raft using some strong cords and some wood. I collected many packages of rubies, emeralds, rock crystal, ambergris, and all the precious stuff, tied them upon my raft, taking utmost care to preserve whatever provisions I could save. And then I started out. I held the two small oars ready in my hand, and I loosened the cord which held it to the bank. Once my raft was on the river, I flew swiftly under the gloomy archway, and I found myself in total darkness, which led me to utter confusion. But thanks to my destiny, I was very smoothly taken forward by the rapid water. I went on, as it seemed to me, for many nights and days. At one place, the channel became so small that I thought that I would be crushed against the rocky roof, but to my surprise, I was safe since I had taken the precaution of lying flat upon my precious packet of stones. To keep myself alive, I ate only the stuff which I thought was the minimum to keep me alive. When I was about to finish my last bit of food, the only thought that entered my mind was, what if I died of hunger? However, I was so tired by that time that I fell asleep in minutes. And when I again opened my eyes, I was once more in the light of the day. I could see a beautiful country before me, and my raft, which was tied to the river bank, was surrounded by friendly-looking dark men. I got up and saluted them, and they spoke to me in return, but I could not understand a word of their language. I was so overwhelmed by my sudden return to life and that light that I murmured to myself in Arabic, "Close thine eyes, and while thou sleepest, heaven will change thy fortune from evil to good." A humble person from their group understood what I said and came up to me and said,
"My brother, don't be surprised to find us here. This is our land. When we came to get water from the river, we noticed your raft floating down it, and one of us swam out and brought you to the shore. We were waiting for you to get up from your deep sleep. Tell us now, where are you coming from, and where you were planning to go through that dangerous way?"
I gave them the true picture of what had happened to me. They were kind enough to bring me a horse to ride, and we set out. I was followed by several strong men carrying my raft upon their shoulders. In this way, we entered into the city of Serendib. The natives introduced me to their king, and I greeted him in my Indian fashion. I went down at his feet and kissed the ground, but the king told me to get up and asked my name.
"I am Sindbad,"
I replied.
"People call me the sailor, for I have spent a large part of my life traveling on the seas. And how come you here?"
asked the king. I told him my true story. There was nothing that I could hide from the king. He was so surprised and delighted to listen to the story of my journey that he ordered my adventures to be written in letters of gold and to be laid up in the archives of his kingdom. Presently, my raft was brought in and the bales were opened in his presence, and the king declared that in his entire treasury there were no such rubies and emeralds as those which lay in great heaps before him. I very humbly told him that whatever I possessed was at his disposal. The king could take whatever he wanted, to which he replied,
"Nice, Sindbad. I would be really glad if I can add something to your treasure than having an evil eye on your valuable possessions. I have something to give you as a token of my goodwill."
He then commanded his officers to provide me with a suitable lodging at his expense and sent slaves to wait upon me and carry my raft and my bales to my new dwelling place.